Welcome to the Rancho Palos Verdes Public Safety Meeting. Before we get started, I ask you all rise and we can do the Pledge of Allegiance. Put your right hand over your heart and repeat after me. Ready to begin.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you all for coming tonight. I'm Captain Dan Behringer, Lomita Sheriff Station, and I'm your Chief of Police for Rancho Palos Verdes. On my left is Sergeant Doug Scheib from Lomita Sheriff Station. Also in the audience from our City Council, we have Mayor Ken Dida, and we have our City Manager, Doug Wilmore. And I'd like to thank the City Council for their support and allowing this meeting to come to fruition. Some of the things we'll talk about tonight are crime statistics and crime trends, our ALPR camera system that the city has purchased along with the other cities on the peninsula that we'll be installing this summer, some burglary prevention tips for both your vehicles and your homes, and home protective measures, home safety, and then we'll talk a little bit about our volunteer program, and then we'll open it up to the audience for questions. So when I'm talking about crime statistics, I will be reviewing the first quarter of 2016, which is January through the end of March. The last year we experienced spikes in property crimes, violent crimes all over the state of California. It was a direct result, we believe, of Prop 47 and AB 109, which is prison realignment, which put literally thousands of prison inmates back on the streets, and virtually with no treatment for drug offenses or any court-ordered treatment programs where we used to be able to do that. As a result, it's a revolving door, and we see a lot of recidivism, and property crimes spike tremendously throughout the state and all our communities. There was a voter-approved initiative, so while there is some fight against it, it's an uphill climb to change things. So what we are doing is the best we can in law enforcement and in the communities to deal with it is ask the folks like you to come out, learn what you can do to protect ourselves and help us deal with this issue. So as you can see, the early part of 2016, crime is down compared to last year. These statistics you see on the screen are the same time period for the last 4 years. Not too many marked differences. However, residential burglaries, which is a really important concern up here of ours, is down slightly to only 24 from 32 last year, up from 20 the 2014, and down from 33 in 2013. Vehicle burglaries are down about 50%. However, lately we've seen a slight increase in this activity again. We've made some arrests recently on the peninsula. Theft from vehicles are still prominent. We see a lot of people leaving their cars unlocked, or leaving property in plain view. For a vehicle to be a burglary, the car has to be locked. Theft from vehicle is classified as an unlocked vehicle or one that can't be locked. Other larceny theft, that includes shoplifting, thefts from yards, any similar crime to that. And grand theft auto, that's another major concern of ours. We saw huge increases in 2015 with that, especially at the latter part of the year. There are certain models of cars out there that are very easy to steal, mainly 90s models, Toyotas and Hondas. A lot of times we'll find these cars close to where they were stolen from. They're just used as joyrides. They're not stripped. Or sometimes they steal them to take the battery out and get the recycling fee for the battery, which is kind of unusual, I think, for all that trouble to go through just for a few bucks.
Motorcycles are being stolen, not as often as we saw
back in the 90s, we had a real prolific motorcycle theft problem, but motorcycles are stolen too. And that's included in the Grand Theft Auto statistics. And arson, virtually don't have an arson problem, which is good. This slide reflects the first quarter of residential burglaries in Rancho Palos Verdes. You can see that scattered throughout the city, no real pattern there, you know, discernible pattern that we could use to, you know, effectively set up a surveillance or anything. The highest frequency of these burglaries occur on Wednesdays and Thursdays. Fridays are pretty prominent. What's really unusual is the number we see on Saturdays, which is, you would figure most people are home in the neighborhoods and would see something. But we still have burglaries on daytime Saturday. Most common time in the latter, earlier part of the year was between 6 and 7 p.m. We believe that was because of the daylight savings time. People aren't home from work yet. It's easy to tell that no one's home when the lights are out in the home. Usually these burglars are just driving through the area looking for an easy target, knocking on doors, pretending, you know, if someone answers, they'll pretend to be a solicitor or ask for someone who doesn't live there. And if no one answers, they usually go around the back and force entry through a window or a door and in and out of the house within 20, 30 seconds, sometimes very quick. Just looking for concealables, jewelry, and cash. We don't see a lot of, you know, big screen TVs going out the doors anymore. They're pretty easy to pick up at Costco and that type of store. So gold is where the profit is with these burglars. They'll take valuable jewelry, throw the gemstones out of them and throw them away, go to the jewelry mart and have the gold melted down and get cash for it within a matter of hours. Back in April, we had a burglary occur on the south side of Rancho Palos Verdes on a weekday morning. The suspect is pictured here. This video comes from the homeowner's surveillance system they had on their home. They received this video within seconds on their cell phone while they were out of state on vacation. They called us and we responded. However, the burglary had already been committed and the suspect was gone. But in talking with the neighbors, they said, oh yeah, this guy was walking around the neighborhood knocking on doors, claiming to be a solar salesman. And they described his car. In fact, one neighbor took a picture of his car. We weren't able to see the license plate in the photo. However, when the burglary occurred, he moved up into the target home's driveway and the plate was not on the car anymore. So before he came back to go to that house, he took his license plate off. I'll show you a video clip. I'll play this, how quickly it was to gain entry to this home. You see, this is on the side of the home. He casually looks in the home and he's got some sort of a spring-loaded center punch device you can buy at an auto parts store to gain entry by breaking the glass. You can see there the glass is shattered. All he has to do is push his hand through and unlock the door. We got that video that morning. We decided, let's put this on the media, on local television. Someone will recognize this guy. He's pretty, stands out. We have a description of his car. Within a few hours, we had tips from all over Southern California, some of them from solar salespeople. He said, this guy used to work for me. So he did have a background and knew the lingo to use and had some background when he did knock on a door and talk about this. Surprisingly, he was not from our area. He was from the Canyon Country area up near Santa Clarita. He was a prolific drug user. He was wanted. As soon as this broke, other police departments and police agencies started calling saying, hey, we're looking for this same guy too for burglary. We also found out he had done an armed robbery a few days before this. So our surveillance team, we have a team of detectives at Lameda Station that are funded by the Peninsula Cities called the Surveillance and Apprehension Team. They worked with the Santa Clarita Sheriff Station and did some surveillance trying to locate them. Santa Clarita Station on the April 22nd, a couple weeks later, he returned home to his parents' house. They took him into custody. He had a gun that was used in the robbery that LAPD wanted him for. And the gun was stolen out of a burglary in Ventura. So he's looking at charges in Ventura County, South Pasadena, Canyon Country, Agoura Hills. He was all over the place. So that morning, we were thinking he's probably local, you know, Torrance, South Bay, maybe San Pedro. We had no idea that we'd be dealing with someone that was from so far away. I'd like to introduce Deputy Reese Souza and Deputy Tammy Baus. They're part of our core team. They were on a call for service. That's why they're late. And we apologize for the late entry. So on the subject of Grand Theft Autos, I talked about the most common types of cars. This is the first quarter of the 2016 where our Grand Theft Autos have occurred. Again, it's kind of sporadic, but you see most of them are off major streets. We've got a few off the Western Corridor and a few off Hawthorne Boulevard. Most common day of the week for Grand Theft Auto seems to be Thursday right now. Overnight is the most frequent time. And during this time, we've had three arrests for Grand Theft Auto, and that's in the first 3 months. In addition to the other gentleman I talked about, we arrested for burglary. We had six residential burglary arrests in the first quarter of 2016. And just to give you an idea of how many burglaries we had in Rancho Palos Verdes, in 2015 as a whole, we had 183. So we're off to a better start than last year, but one is too many in my eyes. So we're continuing the fight. And the city council, of all four cities on the peninsula, have been very, very supportive. They've approved the AOPR project, which is automatic license plate reader. This contract is going to be signed shortly with all four cities with a company who's won the bid. We'll be starting installation in the next couple of months. For those of you who don't know, an ALPR is a camera that reads license plates of every vehicle passing through a lane of travel on a thoroughfare. If that car is reported stolen, or it's wanted for a crime, or associated with a missing person, or someone has a warrant, an arrest warrant associated with that, we get an immediate alert at the sheriff's station. And it comes up with a picture of the back of the car and the license plate. It doesn't show the occupants, shows the back of the car, usually, or the front, depending on the camera angle. But if it's a serious crime, a burglary or missing person or a wanted person or wanted for a felony, we will dispatch units to that area and try to locate them. Now, these are going to be placed all over the peninsula in Rancho Palos Verdes, Rolling Hills Estates, and Palos Verdes Estates. So we'll get to questions when I can get you a microphone, because it won't be picked up on the TV. So at the end, we'll hold our questions till the end, and we can answer any questions for you. Thank you. So in the event the vehicle does pass through, we'll get an alert and a vehicle description, the whole license plate and direction of travel, and we'll dispatch units and possibly a helicopter if they're available to that area to try to locate them. And I've worked at Lakewood Sheriff Station. We had numerous cameras in that area, and it was very successful. We relocated, I think the first year and a half of having those, we had 64 recovered stolen vehicles just in that one city alone, as a result of the camera system. I mentioned earlier that we're seeing a slight uptick in thefts from vehicles and vehicle burglaries on the peninsula, as well as all the communities in Southern California. So I urge you and your neighbors to lock your vehicles at night, even if it's in your driveway. Ensure that there are no valuables in plain sight. Most of these are crimes of opportunity, and a lot of the reports I'm reading that are coming in lately are unlocked vehicles where they were parked in the driveway unlocked. And there's laptops and all kinds of good things in the car. I would urge you to consider installing a security motion light on your driveway to, in the event someone gets near your car, a light would come on. And we'll talk about some of the other things to secure home, but those are some just to combat these vehicle burglaries, especially at gyms, parks. When people go park their car and go hiking, they don't want to bring their purses, cell phones, they leave them in the car. Well, the crooks know this, so they're easy targets. So if, when you go to a park or go work out at the gym, make sure you're not leaving any valuables in your car, especially in plain view. I also, to prevent auto theft, I recommend the steering wheel locks. There are a couple of them out there. One of them, you know, the most popular is a club. They're very effective too, because these thieves aren't professional car thieves that have tools with them to break these. Usually they're opportunists and they want to just get a car and get out of the area quickly. And also car alarms. They're a great deterrent, especially if they have a flashing light in the car that the thieves can see. As we move on here, I'm going to pass it over to Deputy Sousa and Deputy Tammy Baus to talk about home protective measures and home security audits. I know some of you grabbed our paperwork we had out there with the checklist. And without further ado, I'll hand it over to them. Turn on your mics.
Okay. Good evening. The core team, what we do is we meet with neighborhood watch groups, things of that nature. We typically go to the meetings if they have specific questions. If your group has questions, we bring statistics. So you can kind of see what's going on in your little chunk of the city. As far as the home audits and the measures that you can take that apply everywhere, some of the stuff that we definitely push for are the alarm systems for both for your cars and for your homes. And I've been at Lameda Station for 20 years. In the 20 years that I've handled calls here, I would say I've had about three or four where houses got hit with alarms on them. And that's two or three of those were in the last year or two. Typically, that keeps them from coming in. If it sounds, you might have a back window broken out. That's what they normally do. And then they go in the house and they have all day without an alarm. With an alarm, they usually beat feet because they know we're on the way. And things you can do to prevent being that house that they pick out, it's keeping vegetation cut back. Don't give them, when they drive down the street, they look at things, how can they be hidden? How can they pull up somewhere and not be seen? So you want to kind of take that element away from them. And like my captain said, lighting is huge. That's a big one. And make it known so that something happens so that it triggers either an alarm or a light so that attention is on them. And one of the big things that you can do, huge, is neighborhood watch groups. If you're not part of one, I encourage you to be in one. To if you don't have one, you know, be the one that gets out there and starts one. Some of the other crimes, did you talk about the like mail theft?
No, I didn't touch on mail theft.
Mail theft is huge. It's the crooks that are out there, they want information any way they can get it. They actually were breaking into houses. You would think, you know, the days of seeing them walking down the street with your TV, they don't really do that. They're looking for jewelry. They're looking for things that are easily hidden. So jewelry in the pocket. They're not taking TVs and stereos. Given if you let them sit in your house all day, possibly they would. But they want to get in, grab, get out. So you want to secure those things in a safe that's bolted down. Safes that aren't bolted down, you're giving them a treasure chest. So you want to bolt those down. But your mail, there's a lot of valuable information in there. You want to make sure that your mail doesn't sit out in the mailbox all day long. And the criminals have ways of getting mail out of a mailbox. And I won't go into details how, but if you put your mail in a mailbox on a street corner, there's ways of getting that mail out. You want to make sure if it's important mail, if it has information related to your identity, social security numbers, bank account numbers, checking account numbers, things where they could go out and possibly get more credit in your name. You want to make sure you take that into the post office. That's what I've done for as far back as since I've been on this department, when you learn about all the different things that they do. So the corner mailbox, not really good for things that have important information. And
also the mailboxes at CVS, the blue boxes, or the boxes outside of the post office are also being targeted. So it's better to walk in, take that extra minute to walk in and drop your mail, outgoing mail, into the post office. Also, you touched on service audits. If you guys are concerned about your homes and you'd like a deputy to come out and kind of assess your property and see what you can do to protect yourselves, then feel free to call the station. You can call the core team, and we can come out and check your property for you and help you out that way.
There are a number of inexpensive devices you can put on your home that are very good deterrents. That includes dummy cameras that look like a real surveillance camera, or you can buy a surveillance system pretty cheaply at one of the big box stores. And they have like you saw, they have surveillance systems that will go directly to your mobile device and show you what's going on. And as well, there's doorbell cameras. So if someone rings your doorbell, you get to see from your cell phone who's ringing your doorbell, and you can talk to them on the PA system like you're in the house, even if you're not there. They're not expensive. Those are very good tools to have.
Did you touch on vacation?
We also do vacation checks. If you're going out of town, or you won't be home, you call the station. Our volunteers on patrol do regular vacation checks. They'll check it for you daily. You just give them a list of what cars are there, what cars should be there. If you have someone coming to pick up your mail or feed your pets, always let us know that information. Yeah.
And like I said, they as a criminal, when they drive into a neighborhood, they look for houses that have overgrown shrubbery out front, because that creates a shield, I forgot what was the last thing you were talking about.
Those disposable little flyers.
Oh yeah, they look for the trash piled up on the front step. I lost my train of thought. So if you have a week's worth of newspapers and flyers, that's definitely something that you want to have a neighbor pick up, have somebody pick up. If you have a vacation check, our volunteers will pick that up and move that for you. We have a program, our Volunteers on Patrol program, and they're very helpful. They help do things that we just don't have the manpower to do. And working together, it creates kind of a better team. If they do a check and everything's fine, then everything's fine. But if they find something, which they do sometimes, find an open door, or worse, a broken window, something that's probably going to be a burglary, they call us. We go out and we actually go out and clear the house, make sure there's nobody in it. But Neighborhood Watch, having a way to communicate, to find out what's going on, to get that information out there, calling us, if you see something, call. And we get a lot of our arrests come from that. There's a weird car parked out in front of the house, and somebody's in the car, and somebody else went in the backyard. We get there, and it turns out we end up making a great arrest out of it. Okay, so your guys' help, that's a pretty big thing too.
It doesn't matter the time of day. Just yesterday, someone called on from the Eastview area and said, hey, there's a guy and a gal asleep in a car in front of my house. They've been there for 20 minutes. This is the middle of the day. So our deputies got there, found they were in possession of illegal drugs. The car was full of stolen property. That would trace some of that property back last night. They had been on an all-night binge and theft run from South Orange County through Long Beach all the way to the east side of Palos Verdes. And luckily they got tired and fell asleep, because it enabled us to catch them. So now we're dealing with going back and finding the victims, getting their property back to them.
All from a phone call.
From a phone call. So if I'm back to vacations real quickly, the best thing you can do is tell your neighbors, get to know your neighbors, tell them you're going to be out of town, because canceling your newspaper, canceling your cable, that's just telling more strangers that you don't know anything about that you're going to be out of town for a prolonged period of time. It's not always the best thing. And Sergeant Shive will chime in with some more tips for you.
Yeah, I'll try to make this quick. I'm not like my partners who can do this off the cuff. I kind of have to write a list here, so bear with me. And I recognize some of you in the audience that I've spoken to you before, so hopefully there's something new. But what I've done over the last year to two to my whole career is I've been talking to inmates. And when you have a large family, you got to work that overtime. So I'm at the Men's Central Jail and CRDF, the Women's Jail, and I'm actually interviewing these inmates. I'm interviewing the crooks to try to get, you know, everything I can out of them. And most of them want to be out of their cell, and they want to be, you know, have one of these jobs that we offer them. So I've kind of let them know, you want to get out, you want to, you know, get out of your cell, well, you've got to give me some information. So it kind of works here. So I'll go over a few things with you, and hopefully I'm not too repetitive. But like, for instance, on alarms, I've been to a burglar alarm call that turned into a burglary here on the Hill, where the alarm that puts out the part that puts out the sound that's you know, deafening was knocked off the wall. And so then they continued on and ransacked the house. Double check your alarm, make sure it's up on the second story, up in the rafters, so that they can't get to that. Cameras. I've spoken to numerous inmates, some that out of Nickerson Gardens. Believe it or not, Nickerson Gardens, if any of you guys are aware of that, they have cameras up in the lights on the outside. And so one of the female inmates was telling me how, well, we know when you see that little blinky red light, we know you're watching us. So we take it inside. So the same with your cameras, whether they're real or they're, you know, some of these, you know, fake ones that are cheap. Make sure they have a light, make sure they're in plain view so that the burglar right away sees you have a camera. Burglars do not want you home. Keep that in mind. They aren't going there. So what they do is they start at the front door. I know this has priority been said, but they start at the front door and they're knocking on your door. They're casing your house. So I know there was a situation here on the Hill where a lady said, well, I heard him knocking and I just ignored him. So I went upstairs to take a shower. Lo and behold, they came in through the back door. Her house is ransacked while she was upstairs taking a shower. Let them know, ladies, yell out a man's name, you know, give your, you know, deepest voice you can. Let them know that, you know, either you don't want them there or you're yelling for a man, because they'll move on. And that's a goal. There's those little cameras on the alarm or on the doorbells. Those might work, but we actually had recently a burglary not far off a Black Horse where she told me she hit the button, she saw that he was there, but she didn't yell out anything. She didn't, so he went to the back. Now, we actually caught this man, thank goodness. He tried to get into the back door, and our deputies were right there, and they caught him. There's a book that I highly recommend called The Gift of Fear by Gavin DeBecker, and there's a lot of times when you know there's something wrong. You know there's somebody on the street or walking by or driving by, and you can't put your finger on it. Well, The Gift of Fear, this book talks about real life stories of where, unfortunately, the women did not pay attention to that sixth sense, and they became victims. But I highly recommend it. It's easy read, and it'll just, you know, hold your attention through the whole book. Know that these burglars are casing your house by sitting down the block, sitting in nice cars that fit in. They have the paper plates many times, and they're trying to get your routine down. You got to mix it up a little bit, you know. And what they do is, as they're sitting down there, whether they have binoculars or just trying to fit in. So if you sense that, you want to call. Now, here's something you want to think about. Well, what do I say to the police? What do I tell them? I mean, you know, I'm calling dispatch. Well, here's what you don't say. You know, I don't think this is anything, but I just want to, well, if you start off with, I don't think this is anything, or I think this is small, guess what the person on the other line's thinking? Why should I send a guy out? You just told me there's nothing going on. We're not asking you to yell you saw a gun when you didn't see a gun, but we're asking you to share with them details of what you saw, the car, a partial license plate, the color, description of the person in the car, why you feel it's suspicious. Okay, share that. Know that the person on the other line, they need some details, right? When the burglars, there's a, and we're not trying to, you know, get you to run out and buy a bunch of things, but there's, I see a couple in the audience, and I know that they kind of filled me in on this. 3M. It's a type of clear covering that you can put on the windows. Like, for instance, we saw the video of the guy breaking the window with the punch, right? If you had this product on your windows, that wouldn't have worked. He would not have got in that easy. He would have literally had to probably kick and kick until he got through that window. Nothing's cheap, but I highly recommend you look to reinforce the vulnerable spots on your home. I did a home audit about 2 weeks ago, and one of the ladies that was up here in RPV, and she says, I'm going to get new gates. And she showed me her gates, and we looked at it, and I said, well, and I walked up on a mound of dirt that was just above her gate, and I said, well, what about this? I can just pop over your fence here. Oh, I never thought of that. I was going to get new gates. Well, lo and behold, she needs to get more than new gates. She needs to put something on top of that wall so they can't just pop over there. And that's why the home audits are good. We're going to see something, or we're going to bring it to you know, or you're going to see something that you didn't even realize as you're walking your property. Think about this. If somebody gets into your house, what room are they going to go into first? Master bedroom. Why the master bedroom, ladies? The jewelry. Why are you keeping all your jewelry right there for them, right? Of course you need to live. And of course, you know, if you're wearing your jewelry and you wear it daily, that's fine. But I'll tell you, get it out of the bedroom, right? I don't know. I personally have never seen a kitchen ransacked. Maybe that's a spot. You know, a bank, a lockbox. You know, take your valuables out of your house. Maybe leave them a little something. It was kind of cute when I was talking to that lady on the home audit. She goes, you know what? You're right, because if they break in and they can't get anything, they might vandalize your house. She goes, I'm going to leave them a $100 bill. That's what they get. So that's what she said. I said, that's all right. I know this was brought up, but I want to emphasize it again. When you go out of town, who cancels their newspaper and their mail? You cancel it, right? You cancel it? And some are saying no. I know it's already been brought up. You don't know who you're talking to on the other line, right? You're kind of giving them a nice list that they can tell their friends or they can use for themselves. So you'll want to have a good neighbor pick it up. And I know that's been said, but I wanted to reiterate that. You know what? We do offer a ride-along program. I highly recommend that you come out with us. See, what is it like to be in a police car? It's not going to be the movies, I can tell you that right now. But you can ask a lot of questions one-on-one. You're going to learn something. You can go out for 1 hour or 8 hours. We do a quick background check on you, and I think you'll enjoy it. Almost to the number, everyone has said, you know, I really enjoyed that time. Large dogs, can't emphasize that enough. We have a posse out there on your trails. Our VOPs are going to come up and talk to you. Our volunteers on patrol, they'll come and tell you what they do, which is so crucial. Be careful with social media, that you're putting out things that you're on vacation, right? You don't want to do that. And don't stereotype. Do not think you know in your mind what a criminal looks like. Not far from Penn High, I talked to a lady up there. She's a doctor. Her husband's very successful. Their 19-year-old son was doing many of the vehicle burglaries. Okay? So I could keep going. My list goes on, but I'll stop right there for lack of time. Thanks.
You mentioned the VOP program. We are always in need of volunteers on patrol. Like Sergeant Scheib described, they have a number of duties. From vacation checks to coming out and assisting on calls with traffic control to working at the station counter, numerous things. And we have some volunteers in the audience tonight, and we will open it up for any questions and let them give you an idea of what it's like working in the volunteer program. Who do we have here?
Ted, would you like to come forward, please?
Have them stand behind us, not in front of us. Okay.
Yeah, you can stand right in between.
So they can get you on the camera. This is being recorded for RPV TV.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Ted Rubenstein, volunteer at Lomita Station. I've been volunteering there for 5 years. And let me briefly tell you what today was like, because I had a very interesting day. Came to the station with the intention of going on patrol. I headed out only to hear that there was a 902T call, which is a traffic collision with unknown injuries. It was in Rancho Palos Verdes on Caddington Drive off of Western Avenue. When I arrived there, fire and rescue were there, but no deputies. So I waited and called the station to make sure that somebody was responding to the call. It turns out it was a very busy morning, and deputies wouldn't be there for a few minutes. So when fire and rescue left, I protected the traffic scene. I made sure that the cars couldn't get anywhere near the incident. And shortly thereafter, when the deputies arrived, he asked that I stay where I was and control traffic while he took the report and determined who was the guilty party. That was just the beginning of the day. On the way home from there, I ran across another deputy whose lights were on in the left-hand lane on Western Avenue. He was protecting a car that was disabled. So he asked whether I would stay there so that he could go off and do what he does best, patrol and answer calls, and I did. And about 15 minutes later, there was a tow truck that was called, and I was able to leave. That was the most exciting part of my day. Later that afternoon, while patrolling in Lomita Station, I was able to write a parking citation for expired tags, and then another one for blocking a disabled access ramp. And then I came here. So that was just one of my days, and I really felt like I contributed. I was able to do something that deputies appreciated and something that enabled them to get back on the road and patrol and answer calls. Thank you.
All right. With that, I think we'll open it up for questions. I know many of you are eager to ask us questions that we can answer specifically. If I could have Ted, if you can.
Is this on?
No, I'll turn it on for you. No, it's on.
So, and I can pass it on.
Okay. Sergeant Shive will walk around the mic so we can hear you and they can hear you in the recording studio, and we'll answer your questions.
Thank you for your service. On the very first slide, you showed two rapes in 2016. Is that right?
Yes, ma'am.
And can you tell us where those occurred?
I won't tell you where they were. I can tell you, though, that one of them was reported from 1970. It was a late report. It's some people where they're seeing a therapist and they're urged to make a police report. So it was a late report. And the other was also a delayed report. And it was all, none of these are stranger type incidents. They were known suspects. So we don't have any trend of any sexual assaults going on the Hill with
so
predators.
Zero for 2016 now. And last year there was one. Is that right?
That's correct.
Thank you.
Hi, Lee Williams. What can you tell us on the about the motorcycles that were running around and causing havoc?
Well, very interesting question. It's a hot topic on the east side of the peninsula near the switchbacks. With social media, the popularity of that stretch of roadway has gotten out of hand. And with the type of bikes today with the modified exhaust, very loud, in addition to some culvert work that was done in the canyon that seems to help with the echo and it increases the decibels of the sound in that canyon. We've had a campaign we started recently for strict enforcement for speeding and equipment violations, namely exhaust. And we've hired extra deputies to patrol that stretch, working specifically for car racing and motorcycle racing. In addition to us putting out information on social media saying we're taking zero tolerance approach, and we put signs up, electronic signs, warning motorcycles there's a zero tolerance approach. And from what the feedback we had so far in the last couple of weeks, it's been very successful. I can't promise that'll continue because we don't have any control over the motorcycles when they come in, when they don't. But if the word gets out that we're not going to tolerate it and they're issuing expensive tickets, we hope that will solve some of the problem. Any questions? Next question. Bring you the mic.
What is your average response time and what is the longest response time?
Well, that varies on situation. Our average for an emergency call, which is lights and siren required, we'd call that an emergency response, is about 3 minutes. That's the average, 3.5. Routine, it would be a report call type thing. We're averaging 20?
Probably more.
About 20 minutes. And a priority call, which is not to the level where we respond with lights and siren, but it's a call that needs to be answered quickly. A crime just occurred, maybe a property crime, not where someone's injured, usually under 12. The factors for response time, I can't tell you. There could be one thing going on one side of the hill and units have to respond, or it just depends. It depends on the time of day, traffic, and a bunch of variables. But we're under the department mandates, well under our department mandates for averages for response time. We're very satisfied with our what we're doing.
What about reducing it by a factor of 30%?
I'm sorry?
Instead of 12 minutes, how about 8? What would that take?
Well, anything we can do to increase our, to be more efficient and decrease our response time would be great. We don't have control over how fast we can get there sometimes. But it's important to us, and we track it monthly, and the department tracks it, and we share that information with the city on quarterly reports, and that's it's something we look at. And one thing on response times, too, I see some of the stuff that goes out on social media. There was a recent robbery, and said it took the deputies 20 minutes to get there. Well, reality, the victim hadn't called for 15 because he couldn't. His phone was stolen during the robbery, so he had to wake someone up in the neighborhood and get someone to let him use the phone. So there was 15 minutes, and when we got the call, our response time was actually 3 minutes. Because we're in the same neighborhood for the same crooks who had committed a separate crime after they robbed him. So sometimes social media is great for getting information out, but it only gives one side of the story, and a lot of misinformation can get out there. But if you do call and you're talking to a dispatcher, if you're a victim of a crime or a witness, they're asking you questions, description, what occurred. Keep in mind that at that time they're asking you all these questions, it may seem very frustrating that why aren't they sending somebody? They're sending someone. They're typing in the call. That deputy is en route. And a lot of times, if that deputy has sufficient information on what he's looking for, he's not going to go to you right away. He's going to circle the neighborhood and try to find that individual's responsible before they come talk to you. So they're actually at the call. They're just not there with you yet, but they're actually actively looking for the suspects. There's a, sir, in the second row, do you have a question first?
This actually came from the core team, I believe, and that is the concept of hiding valuables in a child's room or among child's toys and that kind of thing. Since it came from you guys, why don't you take it?
Yeah, the putting them in a different place, that's a one method. And then the other is just to, like he was saying, they go to the master bedroom every time. Every time they go to the closet, they dump drawers upside down, they pull all the drawers out, and that's when they're in a hurry. They'll go room by room by room if you don't give them a reason to get out of your house. That I've seen where, I mean, every single room, 3,000 square foot house, every single drawer is out. So you gotta get them to cut it down to where they will maybe just run into one room, flip a couple of drawers out. But if you get yourself, like say for jewelry, you can have your jewelry box out, and if you have a couple pieces, you know, but maybe get that one it's fireproofing too. So if your house burns down, you can have, if you have any important documents in there. I'm not talking a giant gun safe, but just something that can be firmly attached, bolted down to the ground. I have two safes. I have one that's like the size of a refrigerator, and I still bolt that. That one's bolted down, and then I have another one, a small one that's for quick use, so you don't have to... You know, spend all day trying to get in and out of it. Because going in and out of a safe is, I mean, it's kind of a nuisance. But just secure it, because if they can't get it easy, they're not going to take it. They just won't invest the time in it. Ultimately, if a crook wants something that you have and you over-secure it, they have other ways that they will. There's always a way for them to do what they want to do. But for the most part, they're lazy. that's why they're doing what they're doing, because they don't want to go out and work for a living. They want to just take what you've worked to get. So just make it inconvenient for them. And like I said, with the whole property thing too, the not allowing them time. If you set your property up because you want it to feel really secluded and like you're in your own little world, that's what they want. They want to be in their own little world and not be bothered by us. So just give them a reason to get out and secure your stuff so that if they're given 20 minutes, they're not going to be able to get it.
There's something else called stash cans. You can find them on the internet, or there's a few stores in the area that sell them also, but they're cans that look exactly like a household product or perhaps a Coke can, and it's hollow inside, and you can stash things in there. Just be aware, you don't want to let your housekeeper know, but they have been known to throw those stash cans away because they think it's an empty product can. So that has happened. So, but something else, that's a good deterrent too.
A popcorn kernel can in your bedroom looks a little out of place, and they may
figure that out. Yeah, you might want to keep that in the kitchen.
Keep in mind that these are commonly used to receptacles for narcotics too. So right. The narcotics users might know what they are.
Right.
A question. I'm sorry, she's been waiting for a while up here in the front.
Okay, next.
We'll get around to everyone.
Have you had any experience with these dots that you're supposed to paint on valuables? Is that helpful? Because I bought them and I haven't used it yet because my daughter, the first thing she said was, Mom, what happens if you sell a thing and it has your identification on it?
What she's talking about are the dots that have a microscopic identification number, and I believe they can be seen with a fluorescent light.
That's true.
But we don't have a contract, the sheriff's department, with any companies to do that. So, I mean, for us to decipher it, I don't know if we're that to that point yet. It may come in the future, but at this point, we're not under contract with anyone. So we wouldn't be able to help you with that.
One thing along those lines, if any of you guys have ever had something insured in your house beyond just the structure, what's the first thing the insurance company wants to do? They want to come out and take pictures of it. If they're insuring a necklace or a ring, they want to see it. They want to take a picture of it. It doesn't hurt to have pictures of things that potentially could disappear. I've taken pictures of serial numbers on things because writing them down is just a pain. And you'll forget where you put the paper. But I take pictures of a lot of my stuff, so I have identifying marks if I ever need to report it stolen or if it ends up missing. Because we run across stuff all the time, and we run serial numbers all the time. And you can run them in the computer, you can run them over the radio, and they almost always come back. Even though it's a guarantee that they've been stolen at one point. Nobody has those numbers for us to be able to put in the system. So if you were to have pictures of it, that would definitely benefit you in that if something ever did get taken, and the dots would be an extra added thing, but the picture is always, pictures are worth 1,000 words. We attach it with a report, and if somebody comes across a car full of stolen merchandise, we have something to kind of compare it to as far as looks go. Okay.
I live on PV Drive East, and thank you so much for the recent initiative regarding the motorcycles. It does seem to have had an effect the last few weeks.
Is the button off on the mic?
Oh, okay. But we do have an ongoing problem, and that is traffic speeding, not traffic from out of the area, but locals. And I live on the patch between Via Corsini and Miralles Plaza, and I regularly every day have cars going past at 60 miles an hour. Is there something that the Sheriff's Department can do?
Well, sure. I will pass that on to our traffic office and have them. They'll let our deputies know that this area is a problem, and they'll spend some time there. And usually, some visibility and a couple of citations, will get people to slow down because they'll expect to see a black and white there when they round the corner.
Hi. I don't have a question. I'd just like to share an incident that happened last night. We actually called you guys, and you came out, so thank you for that. My wife came home late from work last night, about 11:30. We live right across the street from Marymount College, so right by the switchbacks on Casalina. Very foggy last night, so visibility was poor. As she pulled in, rounding the corner from our street in front of our driveway, she noticed a gentleman standing next to our neighbor's house just on the curb. Thought it was a little strange, kind of late at night, so she pulls into our driveway and then sees a car directly across from our house parked in front of another neighbor's house, a car that nobody ever parks there, so it was odd. About that time, she noticed in her mirror the gentleman that was on the street is now at the foot of our driveway waving his hands at her, trying to get her attention for some reason. And about that time, two gentlemen in that car got out. So she was calling me on the phone. I'd just gotten out of the shower. I missed her call, called her back. You could hear in her voice. I come right outside. But by that time, they had got back into their car, all three of them, and left. You know, we had a burglary, a break-in in a car a block away from a neighbor 2 weeks ago. So I'm just imagining, you know, they're casing the neighbor's house, two of the neighbors right there for their cars or whatnot. But, you know, it's happening. So just, you know, we texted our neighbors right away because we made friends with our neighbors right around us. So they all came out and just make friends with your neighbors and pay attention to what's going on in your neighborhoods. Because, you know, my wife was a little panicked. She, you know, instead of calling me right away, I told her next time to lay on the horn until I run out of the house. You know, because if somebody, even if my neighbors, if I hear a horn at midnight, I don't care what time it is, I'm coming out. So just a piece of advice, you know, to get somebody out of the house.
Can you share with us what kind of car it was, you know?
It was a sedan. She wasn't really paying attention to it. She was pretty nervous, got scared and just kind of sat in the car trying to call me and was panicked. So, yeah, she just knew it was a sedan. That was it.
Okay.
You know, three gentlemen in our neighborhood shouldn't be there.
That could have went bad midnight. Very quickly.
Yeah,
exactly. She did the right thing.
Yeah.
And it sounds like you did too. You get the word out, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, we text our neighbors right away and we you know, because we all have kids. There's eight of us right there, or eight kids right there between three neighbors. And so we bonded and watch out for each other.
Well, if I could just add something. One thing you guys got to remember, though, and I mean, you hear that? That's not my chest. That's this vest I have on with my Motorola, with my gun. Please don't go out and confront them. Please don't. Unless you are me and you just happen to be stopping by some neighbor house, you come out with all the uniform and everything. We don't need another victim. Be a great witness. And that's what we're trained. When we're off duty, we're told do not go out there and confront people. Please do the same. Call us. You know, get your wife in. Yeah. Well, I might need to sign you up for the VOP program. So talk to me later. Okay. All right. Wonderful.
Thank you.
That reminds me. I'm very concerned about all these solicitors. Just Kyle lives down the street. We're in a cul-de-sac. Kyle's at the bottom of the street. We're towards it. Yeah, this guy came around, house repair, you know. And I have a caregiver that was outside at the time taking care of the trash and so forth. And he saw this guy. My caregiver was going for lunch. And he texted me and he said, Sandy, there's some man walking around your street. Don't answer the door. But what happened, and so then he was in his car, my caregiver was in his car eating his lunch, which reminds me, I've got to tell my street that this caregiver does things like that. He comes early, because he lives way over in Carson, and he comes early, like 45 minutes early, and sits in his car and sleeps in the morning and looks very probably suspicious. And the same thing at lunch, he goes and gets his lunch and eats in the car. So anyway, he was there, and this guy was walking around looking at the people's roofs and knocking on doors and actually passed my house. I guess he decided it didn't need repair. I don't know, or whether I wasn't a good target. But at any rate, I just want to know, is there something that we can do? I'm neighborhood watch chairman for my street, and it's just a cul-de-sac with 12 or 13 houses. Can we say as a street that we don't want solicitors? What leg do we have to stand on? What do we have to put a note on our door? How do we get rid of
them? There's an emblem, a sticker you can get from City Hall that says no soliciting, and that's kind of one of the requirements. And then call us. Usually, if one person calls, there's more than one person that calls. But if if we go out there and contact them, that sticker, that's their advisement. You know, once they see that, they're not allowed to go up and knock on the door and try to sell you stuff.
And we're working on our desk personnel. Sometimes you'll call and say there's a solicitor, and they'll go, well, that's a code enforcement issue. That's one of we're a huge department, and it's a great thing, but that's also a disadvantage of being a huge department. We'll have different people coming and going working our desk. So we try to get out there to the people working the desk that, no, we're telling people to call for anything suspicious, including peddlers, because it may just be a front for a burglar. So send a car. Yes, call. Call the station.
And if nothing else, if they're not, you know, out burglarizing, we chase them out.
Because they don't have a business license issued by the city 9 times out of 10 to be doing that in the first place.
Right. They are allowed to go up and leave stuff. They can leave information. They're not allowed to knock and try to sell things. So there is kind of a, you know, but at least we can contact them, find out what they're doing, identify who they are. And then if all of a sudden, like, hey, we had 3 houses hit on the street where we chased this guy out today, at least we have an idea who it was, you know, that kind of thing.
In regard to the do not disturb sign, it has the Rancho Palos Verdes insignia on it, and if that's posted by and around the front door, then it's my understanding that legally they cannot approach the front door. They can leave stuff someplace, but they're not supposed to actually touch your front door. Now, they have touched, I have found stuff stuck in around my door, but they no longer knock at my door or come around and speak, try to speak to somebody in the yard. So that's been a help. The other thing is that, especially for women, if there's someone at the front door, something that is alarming, like what happened with your wife, remember there's always the panic button on your remote for your car, and it's loud. If somebody's there for good reasons, they'll just put their fingers in their ear and stay there. If they're there for other reasons and a big noise comes from your car through the panic button, those people will move on someplace else. So you've always got that for security if you don't have alarm or security in your house.
Just to touch on the sticker, it's actually more of a do not disturb type situation, so they're not allowed to knock on your door. But they are required by law to attach any flyers to a house, meaning that so they don't blow around the neighborhood. So that's why you'll see them rubber banded to your doorknob or to your mailbox flag or in a little paper bag with a rock in it. That's because they're following the law, so they're just not loose flyers blowing around the neighborhood.
Yeah, if I could address that. Doug Wilmore, city manager here. So while I don't have a final opinion from the city attorney on this issue, they're researching it, and the information that we have so far is that the do not disturb sticker is not enforceable. In other words, you can't call the sheriff and say, this person touched my doorknob and I have this sticker and they should be arrested. That's not something that's enforceable under California law. The cases, because that's been tested, the cases have actually shown that California courts are protecting free speech. They want to allow someone to be able to come up on someone's property and knock and you know, be able to sell whatever they're going to sell or whatever. However, what is enforceable is a no trespassing sign that fits within the city's ordinance. And so we're researching that. We'll be able to get all that information out to citizens and so on and so forth that complies with our ordinance, and that's something that the sheriff can actually enforce. They can't enforce anything unless there's an ordinance that they can prove has been violated. And right now, the do not disturb is effective because it is a sign, but they can't go arrest someone because they've been going up on someone's porch when there's a do not disturb sign. But we're working on the no trespassing and the ordinance with that, and we'll be able to get information out to citizens as soon as we've finalized all that research. Okay?
Thank you.
Sure.
have a small dog. What is the coyote situation in RPV lately? Do you guys deal with that?
I'm going to ask the city manager to come up because we haven't been directly involved with that as law enforcement, fortunately.
Yeah, so the you know, the county works with most of the cities, not all the cities, but most of the cities in LA County their job is to control coyote population and to be able to put human and pet safety to protect human beings and pets. And so what they do in cities around LA County is they trap coyotes if they have complaints or if there's threats against against people and against pets. They do it based on complaints from citizens. And when they trap the coyotes, they kill them. I don't know any other way to say that. It was a surprise to us in RPV that there were, I think, 5 shootings a week or two ago in our neighboring cities, not in RPV. And they were there based on a complaint from residents who had, in one case, a coyote in a backyard with small children present, and the adult couldn't scare the coyote away. And, you know, when coyotes are around human beings, they get bolder. If they're hungry, they get bolder. And so anyway, I have to admit it's new for me. I'm in a community where coyotes are an issue, and so I'm educating myself. But that is the long-standing role of the Department of Wildlife, is that's what they do, and they're under their orders that they don't trap and relocate, but they kill the coyote. So we haven't done anything as a city to impact to alter that or change that, and they're doing the job that they're directed to do by the county. If, for example, a city told them, gee, we just want you to trap and not kill, they wouldn't take that direction. That's what they do as a division, and that's been longstanding for them.
Thank you again.
I have a question about alarm system and cameras. Is it advisable to always have your cameras hooked up to the alarm system so that you have someone calling the police from the alarm company when something's visible? Or is it okay to have your alarm system and a camera system separate? I mean, what would you advise? And connected to that, are we allowed to put cameras on the light poles?
Are you allowed to put cameras on the what?
Up on the light, yeah.
On the city light?
On the street light, yeah.
No. That's a public right-of-way, public property. You wouldn't be able to do that. The video camera alarms are very effective because the alarm company monitors your home right away. And if it looks like there's a burglary, they'll notify us, yes, there's video, and this is a burglary in progress, and we will get there with lights and sirens and a helicopter and the whole deal. So they're very effective. I know they probably cost more. I don't know the costs involved, but any technology that's available that is better than just an alarm, I'd suggest doing it.
So you advise that over getting your own camera system that you just see on your phone and respond to?
Well, they're very effective, too, because it's instant. Alarm companies tend to be busy. They transmit, well, I believe they used to transmit over the phone lines. So if the phone lines had to ring, you know, but I'm sure it's all internet-based now. I'm not involved in the installation or sales of alarms, but they're both very effective. It's just preference. If you don't think you're going to have, you know, some people don't pay attention to their phones all the time. You could miss that video by hours or minutes, and it'll be too late. So with an alarm company, you have the assurance that someone 24 hours is monitoring that if they get an alarm call.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Hello, I live in the Black Horse section, and we've had a number of problems recently. One of the neighbors is thinking about hiring a private security company to patrol the area, and this person wants to get about 100 houses together to do this. And I want to know your opinion. Do you think this is worth doing or not?
I don't have really any opinion on that. They can be expensive, and I don't. Do you have an HOA there or not? No, you don't have an HOA, so this would just be a group of residents. I don't know how you would have a contract with all these different residences with this company, because what if someone didn't fulfill their obligation? Others aren't going to see the benefit of it. Others will. I'm aware of the recent crimes that seem to really spike in that neighborhood, and our deputies are wherever patrolling it. I talked about a robbery earlier that was near there, and but I'm not sure if private policing is the answer to all this, but neighborhood watch, letting your neighbors know, and keeping us informed. That's why we're having meetings like this, so we can share information with you. It's just one aspect of the many things we're doing to keep the crime rate lower on the peninsula.
I've got a question on the vacation checks. One of the things some of our neighbors have discussed with us is if someone's really watching our neighborhood, trying to target people that aren't home, it seems like the volunteers on patrol pulling up in front of a house, walking around it and checking it, and then leaving is like waving a red flag. This house, someone's on vacation.
I'll field that one. It's I can't see it being much different than them watching you load your suitcases in your car. And so they would have to be there at that spot while the volunteer is doing the check. I mean, you know, the what if game kind of thing. You can throw it any different way. But, you know, I'll tell you this. When I go load my car to go on a trip, I'm actually thinking about the fact that I hope nobody's watching me put my suitcases in my car. So you're talking to, you know, Mr. Paranoid here. Like I said, I go to the mail. I go in the post office with my anything that has any kind of value. If I'm not going to be home, I make sure I have lights that are going to come on so that I don't have the only dark house on the street at 7:30 at night. It's just about making it look lived in. And then you know, you don't have to get a volunteer to come check your house. If you have a neighbor, you can always have a neighbor look at it. You know, and they're not going to stand out. But if you're stuck in a position of not having anybody, it's a good way to go. And one other thing that wasn't mentioned, having a way to contact somebody, it's pretty important. I can't tell you the houses I've been to where the house has been ransacked. I'm digging through pill containers. I'm trying to find any way to figure out how to get a hold of whoever they are. If you can leave some sort of contact information with your neighbors, if you do a vacation check, they ask you to give them a contact number. That way, if something does happen, we can call you, and then you can tell us, oh, yeah, hey, my neighbor will take care of boarding up the broken window to resecure your property. But, yeah, as far as the big flag, they would actually have to be there when they do the check. So you're talking about their 1 minute out of 2 weeks would have to line up with the 1 minute out of the, you know, the 2 weeks you're gone that the volunteers there. It's probably not going to happen.
And Reese, if I may, just to add to it, one thing with the volunteers on patrol, I was asking an inmate, one of our trustees actually, I said, let's talk about the volunteers as they're driving around. And this inmate tells me, he goes, well, I'm from Van Nuys. And I can tell you the cars over in Van Nuys that say volunteer on the side, they're driving so fast with their windows up. He goes, I don't pay them any mind. He goes, they're not looking for anything. All they're doing is trying to get from point A to point B. The way we train our volunteers here at Lomita Station is to drive slow, windows down, head on a swivel. So the point is, if they're doing a vacation check, I hope they're calling in that guy who's sitting on your block, casing your house. So that's another positive that you want to look at, is they're not windows up, oh, vacation check, run around three times and jump back in the car. We're training them to actually get out of the car, look up and down your street too. So that's our hope as well, that these burglars are going, oh, we know that they're gonna call the police, so.
At one time when with the
ALPR program, there was talk about partnering with HOAs to put cameras in neighborhoods. Is that still on the books? Is that something that's going to take place, or how, where is that?
Yes, the city's exploring that. They're going out with a RFP for a security company, maybe to allow HOAs to pick one central company that would have a not an ALPR camera, but a video surveillance camera, to store that information on a cloud that we would have access to if there were a crime. And it would be, because there'd be so many HOAs joined, we're looking for a price that would be cheaper than one. So, yeah, it's being looked at and going out for RFP. I'll let Doug come up. I'm glad you came tonight, Doug.
Yeah, that's great. So I will say this is really important to the city council, and so we're preparing the RFP right now, and the goal would be, as the captain said, to have a national company that we've vetted that we believe has the best pricing, the best service that HOAs could consult with to determine the best camera, the best location.
And above all,
I'm pushing it as I'm holding it.
And above all, the footage would be able to be easily accessed by the sheriff's department, so they're not coming out to an HOA and going into some back room of a clubhouse or house to try and look at something, but they can actually go to the cloud to access it very quickly. And so we hope to have that out very soon and be looking. Quite frankly, we don't know the results we're going to get, but we think it will be very attractive because a larger national security company will have the opportunity of any number of cameras in various neighborhoods and key points, as well as homes. I mean, individual homeowners could decide to use this company. And so anyway, that's the goal. We'll certainly get that out to our residents as soon as we have results and things to look at.
Thank you.
I wanted to know about how many volunteer patrol cars you have in service.
Well, we have 4 cars, but right now we have 52 volunteers at the station. That doesn't mean we have 52 that are willing to go out, because they handle various responsibilities, helping our detectives, working at the front desk. Our volunteers would probably give me a harder number, but I believe we're about 20.
Okay. Because as you no doubt know, we had an armed robbery at gunpoint about a block away from my house. And I then saw a volunteer patrol car a couple days later. And my thought was that if we could get more of those patrolling the area, they might be a deterrent.
Yeah, and if I could add, 2 of your RPV councilmen, they have applications. They're filling those out. They have stepped up to go out on patrol. So you even have your council that they know how serious this is.
I just want to share a positive story with my experience with the sheriffs. I came down and asked for some involvement with a situation that's just particular to my neighborhood, and we have some very positive results, so I want to thank the city council and the sheriff's department for helping us with some difficult situations. Thank you.
Thank you.
And thank you, guys. I have a few things I want to talk about. The first is that robbery, or it wasn't a robbery, it was an armed, a gunpoint, at least. I'm still a little bit taken aback from it, because I grew up here in Palos Verdes. I moved here because it was safe, or at least moved back here because it was safe. This happened, I have 2 young kids now, literally, 1 block away from where I live. It's the Black Horse area. And I want to know a couple of things. One, in regards to response time, I think it was a good engineering question, but we all know that increased resources can help with that. Are you hiring any more people? Do you have any plans for fiscal year 17 to add more people to your staff? Or are we just talking about volunteer? And no disrespect, but they don't carry guns. The other question I have is around the license plate tracking system and where are these cameras going to be set up? I understand there's an RFP that's going out, but where's your cloud center? I mean, do people have access to this data? Are you just capturing license plates? Because if that's the case, I mean, it's just big data.
No.
So, I know there's a lot in that. I'm sorry.
There's a lot of questions there.
Yeah.
No, the crime itself, the armed robbery, it was very unusual for that area, for any area, because of the time of day, Sunday morning at 5 o'clock, it's highly unusual. We suspect the suspects were out doing crime all night long and just can't happen. It was a crime of opportunity happened on this individual waiting at a bus bench. I can tell you that some of the property was recovered and we're working on some leads, and it was located far away. So these individuals were not from the area, so we suspect they came in and were opportunists. Response time on that was 3 minutes, but because they also confronted someone on a street over after this individual. So we were on that call. When the robbery call finally came in, we were able to get over there. We don't usually have volunteers out that time of day. I don't think that would have been a deterrent. It was very unusual. We don't see armed robberies that time of day. As far as the automated license plate reader, they're going to be at major intersections. It would have been covered. If the car had plates on it, we're not sure if it did. This technology is not end-all, catch-all. You know, it's going to be the best thing in the world, but it is a huge help for investigations because especially that time of day, had the system been in place, our detectives would have went into the system, looked at all the license plates that went through the camera in that 15-minute period, ran them, see what was out of the area, what kind of car fit the description that was called in, and worked on those leads. And that's one of the big advantages of the ALPR system. It doesn't show a picture of the driver. However, we have that database of license plates that's shared with police agencies all over the county. And so we get a partial plate, two digits or one, we just put two digits in and we'll get pictures of cars with all and where they've been through Alper cameras and what times. It's a huge investigative tool.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
If you have this ALPR system working and you're talking about all the time, you're talking about paper plates. And so I'm thinking that, you know, what happens? It picks up the fact that it's paper or not?
No, it'll be a misread. They have like a 1% error factor, and that's usually the paper plates is a misread because they have to be reflectorized, and it looks for license plates specifically. They're very highly technologically advanced to read plates. So it will not read a, you know, Norm Reed's Honda paper plate on there. So, and our deputies are aware of that, the crooks are getting more savvy and taking their plates off their cars, using those. So if they see a car that has paper plates and they don't have proper registration displayed in the window, they'll stop them for that. It's an issue we have to attack on the side for people trying to get around the system. Any other questions? All right, well, I want to thank Mayor. I'll give the mic to Mayor Ken Dida.
Thank you. You know, you're asking some very good questions and you're asking for a lot of information. We're changing the nature of our newsletter. I know it's difficult to come to council meetings and watch us live on TV, although it's the best show at that time, in my opinion. If you like good comedy. Anyway, we're changing the content of our newsletter because that's going to go to every resident in the community. The first one is going to come out. They come out quarterly. The next one will have information about what the council is doing, very briefly, a topic, what the issue is, what the council has done, and a direct link to the website to get more information. So some of the questions you're asking about ALPRs and what we can do with crime statistics and how we can really attack this major problem that we have, it's our number one priority. Please, when you get your newsletter, don't just say, oh, that's nice, and forget it. Read it. It's going to be important information for you to know. And give us feedback. If there's something you need or want to see in that newsletter, let us know. We're out there to try and keep you as informed as we possibly can and make it as easy for you to become informed. So please read the newsletters. They're going to be worth it. Thank you.
Again, I want to thank everyone for coming out. As you can see, public safety is a huge priority with this city, and it's a huge priority with the residents. I can tell by the number of people that came out tonight to interact with us. That's evident. We plan on having another meeting similar to this in 6 months in October. I hope you all come out and tell your friends about it, and we'll or if you need any vacation checks or call the station for anything. We're here for you. Thank you very much.